target.
So just a bit of a recap for us. Tell us what the deficit was last year that you're projecting, what you're projecting this year.
So we had started out last year with a projection as high as 64 million. That was later revised to approximately 34 million. So I'm rounding those numbers. Just by coincidence, that happens to be the same number that we're projecting right now. So 34 million would be a gap. Now, in terms of the deficit, we are actually predicting a balanced budget. Our forecast shows a shortfall. So our plan is to have a plan in place that would balance the budget. Number one, we would look to certain initiatives that would allow us to get there. Some of the good work that's been done to date, continue to see that improvement and that progress. We would also be looking at some of the benefit of a bit of a leveling off of utilization in some key areas, not all, but some. So year to date, the first 3 months of this year, our number is 4.4 million, and that's a deficit. So if that, the first 3 months, or any indication, we're sitting under 20 million forecasted. Once again, my job, our duty, is to balance.
And if the Ministry of Health doesn't approve that plan, what then?
Another plan gets submitted. So they may be approving, considering all or part, or rejecting certain initiatives. And our job is to just continue to seek and work closely with them to identify a plan that does work and is acceptable.
So last year, again, you were in a similar spot.
Yeah.
And some of the measures you put in place were somewhat successful, but still not quite enough to get to the end of the year, as I recall.
Well, we ended the year with a surplus, more to note that. It was, once again, 4.3 million.
But that was partly due to, I think, reallocated capital funding and also funding from the ministry, correct?
Yeah, not so much the capital funding, but the $20 million injection that we received at year end. That was in recognition of our utilization patterns. Sure. So
I guess how confident are you that your plan is going to be able to succeed at, you know, just at this point next year, or, you know, next March, I think it would be, you can say we balanced the budget?
Well, I have little choice. Okay. It's very much a requirement to achieve that balanced budget. And also in terms of getting our financial house in order, we've been striving and making great success in making improvements to care at the same time that we're dealing with a financial shortfall. So I'm hoping that the short relief that we're seeing right now, with a bit of a leveling off on utilization, some great work that's being done around accountable care, connected care, some of the community-based work that we've been working on, a lot of what we've been doing in and on inpatient units, we're starting to see average length of stay actually reduced. That's a great thing for patients, because what it says is when you're ready to be discharged, we've readied your home or the place you're being discharged to.
So what were those numbers again from, was it City Hospital and RUH that were mentioned there? I didn't catch those. Exactly.
Yeah, those are two that we saw last year as a significant improvement. Okay. I can tell you this year we're starting to see really great progress being made at St. Paul's Hospital. Now, you may be unimpressed when you look at something and say, well, it's a partial day that we've saved, but a partial day multiplied by the thousands of patients that we see means all of a sudden we have capacity. We're paying less in overtime. We're able to staff appropriately. So we're starting to see the payoff of many of those initiatives. And our challenge last year is when you implement mid-year, you don't see the full year until later on.
And I know you were trying throughout last year to make a dent in sick time. Can you speak at all as to how that effort is going at this point?
Yeah, so here's the good news first. On overtime, we reduced it by between 18 and 20%. So great news. On sick time, unfortunately, went up. So when we're looking at it, we're saying, wow, this is defeating the purpose of what we're setting out to do. But I think today it's a recognition that we've been tackling it in absolutely the wrong way. Sending out blanket statements about who should be using and how they should be using and who's abusing isn't really the way to the type of workplace that we want here for people to come to. See, the most important thing I think for me and others is that you want a workplace that you look forward to going to when you wake up, just like all of you. That's what gets you up in the morning. Can't wait for today. We realize that it's really health and wellness that we should be focusing in on. That's what we do. We are a health and wellness organization. So why would we treat our staff any differently? So rather than focus on 3% or 4% of the staff, and by the way, we still will do that. We'll work away at trying to figure out how we end up with them returning to work and feeling productive. Why don't we focus on the whole staff and make sure that they maximize their wellness? So that's where we're at today. I haven't set a financial target. What we've said is let's set a target for how many people we can return who really feel that they're better and enjoying the work that they've come to do.
So is this about stress reduction or preventing injuries or what exactly?
I think it's all of the above.
Okay.
So we know one of the biggest risks to injuries is having another injury. So if we were to actually place people off for a period of time to recover, that could be far better a situation than having them return too soon and getting injured a second time. If we talk about stress, I mean, everyone experiences a certain level of stress, but it's how we cope with that, what policies are in place as an organization to be able to respond to it. So we're recognizing, and this has been a year's worth of work, we're recognizing that our teams who are encountering very tragic situations are being affected, almost post-traumatic affected, and they have no venue to talk to people. So once again, it's that self-reflection that if we're a health and wellness organization, why wouldn't we be providing the kinds of support that we provide to anyone, anywhere, who have encountered a very tragic situation? So stress is definitely there, but there are things that we can do to both minimize but also mitigate.
Tragedies aside, how do you keep morale up in situations like this in back-to-back years?
Yeah, so it's difficult. I mean, lots of uncertainty. And I think what we're going through right now is a clear indication of what's next, what's happening. What we really find, though, is that usually the trepidation about what might be next is a lot worse than the reality of what is next. We're trying to keep communication channels open. I'm writing every week, giving updates on what I know, when I know it. Plans, as they're approved, we'll proceed with keeping our staff up to date. So this is where communication becomes most important. So this isn't just a nice to have, it's a need to have. And to be frank with you, it's the ability to go forward and say, I don't know. I don't know now, but I'll make this commitment. When I do know, I'll let you know.
Can you speak a bit about the line here about generating revenue as part of your balancing plan?
Yeah. So we have we always look at our revenue sources because, I mean, let's face it, we've got these expense lines. So why would we look at opportunities to say, what do we charge for? What should we charge for? What could we charge for? So it's everything from meals. We call them ancillary operations like parking. We obviously made adjustments there last year. We have space. Some of our space is leased. We also have opportunities to maybe co-locate other services, and this building would be an example of that, or a private sector service in one of our hospitals or agencies. So we're looking at all of those revenue sources and asking the question, how could we promote revenue without negatively affecting those we provide care to? What would be a win-win? What would be value?
Ever any thoughts of sponsorships, you know, like the Potash Corp, Saskatoon City Hospital, or something like that?
We do, and that's why we have foundations.
Okay.
So those foundations have been absolutely tremendous. In terms of that revenue source, they're our best proponents of being out there and creating those types of sponsorship. So if you go see Steve Shannon, he'll share everything with you. Children's Hospital, likewise, RUH Foundation, Humboldt, We've got with St. Paul's Hospital, we've got great foundations that are doing that every day. But thanks for the idea.
Do you anticipate any job losses at this point? I know healthcare providers, when they see a deficit like this, always ask that question, will I have a job tomorrow?
Yeah, yeah. And you know, that's been a back and forth in terms of a lot of the tension that gets created around budget. I will continue to be committed to making sure that we focus on patient, resident clients, on quality and safety, and on making sure that if there are changes to positions, to jobs, to work, that we use attrition wherever possible. In other words, we have a healthy number of people that are leaving. Our problem's gonna shift in the next coming year, or the few coming upcoming years, to a situation where we can't recruit people. So the last thing we want to do is create a tension where people are leaving only to be recruited back. They may not be there for us when we need them. So attrition has always been the winner for us. Layoffs, they can be, and they create bumping, they create tension and stress. They affect, instead of a small group of people, many groups of people. So I can't rule anything out. But my emphasis will always be on attempting to do through attrition what we're needing to do. If we have, you know, up to 10% attrition, we're not quite there. That creates a real opportunity that if there's a vacancy, then there's an opportunity.
Refresh me again. Did anybody lose their job last year as a result of the deficit?
Yeah, we had over 70 positions that were reduced. We also through attrition we saw. You heard from budget, over 100 positions that have been dropped off. If you were to look even in, particularly in the administrative areas, we've seen a significant reduction. So we're working with a smaller staff in anticipation for amalgamation and for the creation of the new Saskatchewan Health Authority.
How does a deficit affect patients at all, or does it?
Well, bottom line is a deficit is a sign of sustainability. So our job is not just to create a context where the organization, the operational is sustainable, but also to have the resources in reserve to be able to afford the breakthrough technology or respond in a quick way to what's required. So when I see budget, I actually don't see dollars. When I see deficit, I don't see money. What I see is people, the potential for care providers to provide care. Let's face it, I don't think they're volunteering anytime soon. When we look at budget, we always look at how can we maximize the potential of our people to deliver care. So the impact on patients, it's real. It's real. Our job is to minimize the negative, maximize the positive. Thank you.